So today's lecture will be about potentials for two-dimensional Brownian motion. So suppose we have a two-dimensional Brownian motion this is a random process in RD. When d equal to 2, which satisfies the properties that we indicated in previous lectures. And last time we proved what I called fundamental identity for two-dimensional Brownian motion. Suppose that we have a set which is a union of both sets which is of course a subset of RD R2, and then we will have the following identity: kxy equal jbxy plus integral hbx dz kzy minus wbx. The difference between this and the usual fundamental identity is in two places. First place is where we replace the usual potential with k, and then we also have this additional term WB. So the K is just such integral where U is such that its norm is 1. Last time, this is of course from 0 to plus infinity. Last time we talked about it, and we know that this is in fact logarithm x minus y divided by p with minus. And this WB is a limit as lambda goes to 0 from positive side of the following quantity, which we called WB lambda. It is G lambda is lambda potential of the process. Lambda goes to 0 plus, and of course we also have to multiply by exponent x from exponent expectation x from exponent minus lambda tau b. This was the definition of WB lambda, and such limit is WBX. We proved that such limit exists, and in fact we also have such an identity. Yeah, and what is GB? Just to recall, this was the potential of a queued process. So it was integral of p tx minus y with index b, 0 to plus infinity, where ptb is the density of a queued process. The process queued when it enters b. So this is the density this density is constructed on the additional assumption that when we hit B, then nothing happens, we just die. And so this is the integral of such probability, of course, not always 1. It is less than 1 because it does not count all the cases when we hit B. And yeah, so and HB of course is just hitting probability. This is the probability that X tau B belongs to A under condition that tau B is finite, of course. So this is just hitting probability. And so that we have such an identity, and using this identity we can prove very interesting results right now. And this will be related to equilibrium measure. So now we have to define equilibrium measure. The problem is definition of equilibrium measure in two-dimensional Brownian motion is of course that the probability of hitting any set, any non-polar set, is always 1. So if we ever hit some set, then we hit it with probability 1. That does not give us an opportunity to define an equilibrium measure with a hitting, with the probability of hitting a set. So we need to use something else. And in fact, we might use this WB in some sense. So the definition is equilibrium measure is different. So mu B is an equilibrium measure of B if first of all it has total weight 1, so it's a probability measure. Second, it is concentrated on the regular points of B. And third, its potential is constant if x and y belong to the regular set of regular points of B. And in fact, this constant is called Robin constant. So this Robin constant replaces now the capacity. So as you recall, capacity was the total weight of measure of equilibrium measure, and now since equilibrium measure has total weight 1, so we cannot define potential like usual. So instead, we define this Robin constant. As you recall, the potential of usual equilibrium measure was equal to 1 on the set of regular points, and now it's some constant. So it's kind of vice versa. In the three-dimensional case, or more dimensional, or four-dimensional, or d-dimensional for d greater than equal than 3, we set equilibrium measure to be equal 1 on regular set, and then we look at its weight. And now we do it vice versa. We set that its total weight is 1, and we look at the set of regular points and see what is the value of the potential on the set. So of course, the question now whether such measure exists, whether it's unique. Well, uniqueness we proved last time. We proved that with all such conditions, we have that measure is going to be unique. There can be two measures that satisfy all these conditions, two different measures. So now we have to prove the existence, and I'm going to start to do it with say ball radius r center at 0. So we just take 0, take ball radius r in dimension 2, of course. So this is just a disk exactly as I drew, but of course this has to be ball, right? So And now I'm going to find what is equilibrium measure for such boom. So theorem one is that in fact equilibrium measure of the ball is equal to the surface measure of a circle. So sigma r, as you recall, was the surface measure of d-dimensional sphere, and I also required that it has total weight one. So it's just surface measure multiplied by some constant, so that its total weight is one. So this is exactly corresponds to this condition, this equilibrium measure, right? So at least condition one satisfies, and condition two obviously also satisfies, but so we will need only to check condition three. And the second condition, the second part is that, of course, we have RB, and RB will be equal to minus logarithm R divided by P. This will be Robin constant for the ball. And finally, we can also prove the following, that in fact, we can calculate potential, and this calculated potential will be as follows. It will be logarithm if I recall correctly, it should be maximum of x and r divided by p with minus. Yes. So it is constant when norm x is less than equal than r, as required. So it is constant on the set of regular points of ball, inside the ball. So it is equal to Robin constant, exactly. And outside it is just kx, right? So this is potential of such measure. Now I have to prove that this formula is true. And this is all I need to prove, because by definition then it will be equilibrium measure and we will have Robin constant and so on. So the proof is okay. So first, to prove this, I need to find WBRX, right? And to do that, I will use fundamental identity. I will set x equal to zero. I will take any x and then set y equal to zero. So we will have identity with y equal to zero. Then we will have that jb x zero is obviously equal to zero, because we know that jb is zero when either x or y is in the set of regular points of B. And then we will have that this is integral hbx dz kz zero. This is, of course, by definition, is minus logarithm norm z divided by p minus wbx. And this, of course, again, minus logarithm x. Yeah, but that has is such that its norm is always r. Yeah, because the hitting probability, concentrated hitting probability of set B is concentrated on the circle. So it's zero outside the circle. So from this we obtain that minus logarithm norm x divided by p is equal to minus logarithm norm z, which is equal to r divided by P, and the total weight of HB is always 1, because we always hit, we assume here, we have to assume that B is non-polar. So if B is non-polar, then we will have all this, right? So, but I'm sorry, it's not for any B, but for BR, right? So we know that BR is non-polar, we know that. So now since it's BR, we know that it's non-polar, and we have no problem to say that its total weight is 1. Yeah, so this will be just this. And we obtain that this is equal to logarithm x minus logarithm r divided by p. This is this is only for x outside of BR, right? So we know that in fact, just give me a second. So this is true for norm x greater than equal than r. What happens if norm is less than equal than r? Then we have that WBR is equal to 0, because it has to be 0 in all regular points, right? This is exactly what happens, because I am stopped because I realized that this formula should not work for norm x less than r. So here I had to assume that norm x is greater than equal than r to have such formula, right? Because otherwise this hitting probability will not be like this. It will not have such properties. It will be just delta measure at point x, if x is smaller than r. So x smaller than r is a different case, and in this case we have 0. Okay. I proved that WBR equal to this formula. And we may even write it down using maximum, so it will be actually minus logarithm, I can take plus logarithm, and then write that this is maximum logarithm x divided by r and 1. Zero. So this is like logarithm plus, sometimes denoted as logarithm plus. So this is WBRX, and now we will find K mu B at point X, which is equal to integral KXY mu B dy. And because of that, using, again, since this is, we have that mu b is sigma r, right? So we've put sigma r here, and we have to find such integral. Of course, this integral can be just calculated using parametrization of the circle, but it is easier right now for us to just use fundamental identity again. So we replace kxy with the corresponding formula, and again jb xy will be zero because y again when we on such circles and y is regular point, so jb xy will be zero. So this will be equal to hb x dz. So there will be two integrals. K z y sigma r dy. Okay. And what do we have? Usually for we also have minus w b r x, right? So integrating by y with total measure one does not change this. So this is what we will have as additional additional part of this formula. And note that this again, this is because this measure sigma r, it is invariant with respect to orthogonal transformation. This kzy sigma r dy for all z, it only depends on the norm z, right? So this is also true that this is depends only on the norm, but this means that it is some constant, we call it CR, right? So this is some constant CR. So in fact, we have that this is CR minus WBRX. And from this, we may move for that, for example, setting X equal to such that, okay, first of all, we know that if X is less than equal than R, then K mu BX is equal to this constant always, because W will be zero, right? And if even more, if X is equal to zero, then CR will be just integral of K0y over sigma r, so it will be just minus logarithm. So we know, in fact, we know such constant. This constant will be K mu b 0, and it is minus logarithm r divided by p. So this is just this constant. And we have that our k mu b is equal to some constant on the set of regular points of b. And this constant, this is what we required for the equilibrium measure. So it is equilibrium measure, and Robin constant is this constant. And all we have to do is finally to prove theorem, just to say that this formula is also true for the potential, but I already written it down, so I only have to write that k mu b x equal to cr minus w b r x, and recall that this is known too. So, and as we recall, this for x greater than r, for norm x greater than r, we have such formula, and in fact, we will have that this equals to minus logarithm norm x divided by p. So this is exactly what I claimed before. So yes, we know that the ball in two dimensions has equilibrium measure in this specific sense. And we found the corresponding constant, which is Robin constant. So to do the same for any set, well, I do not know for any set, but we may do the same for any bounded set. So now theorem two is suppose that B is bounded. It is as before the union of some the countable union of closed sets. And suppose that B is non-polar. So we actually visit set. And since it's bounded, we may assume that the B is a subset of some BR for some R greater than zero. So this is the assumption that it is bounded. It just can be rewritten like this. So there exists R. Let me do that. So when the, if this is true, then there exists equilibrium measure of B, and it is equal to integral which we have to integrate . So if we take this measure from any set, then it means that we it is the same as we integrate the values of hitting probability of set B over all starting points inside the ball of radius R over the equilibrium measure of this ball. So in fact, we integrate over just a circle, because we know that this is just sigma R. But yeah, but definition is like this. So there exists such measure that satisfies this equality, and it is an equilibrium measure. And in fact, RB, the Robin constant, will be equal to the following: minus logarithm R divided by T plus integral WB integrated over sigma R dx. So this will be the Robin constant for any set B, so we represent it using this WB. Yes, so this is a statement. So let me prove this. So the proof is that we just need to check what is potential of the measure B. So we need to check what is K mu Bx. It is again by fundamental identity. We know that. Okay, first of all, let me just use the definition of mu b, rewrite it as double integral mu b d mu b r dz h z dy. So this by definition of mu b. And then I use fundamental identity, but I use it twice. So I use the symmetry of the fundamental identity. So by symmetry of the fundamental identity, I can see that this part is symmetrical, this part is symmetrical. So if I exchange x and y places with each other, the only thing that changes is integral with hb and wb. So in fact, we can use fundamental identity twice to prove that kxy, I'm talking about this part, talking about h part with integral with hb. So I'm using fundamental identity for b. So we may exchange z and x with each other. So let me rewrite it so it will be clear. Kxy hbzdy. So this is the same as exchanged with x and z exchanged, but I need to take into account that I also have wb in this formula. So it will wb, I have to subtract wb and add wb. Yeah, so not from x, but actually from z here, right? So we, yeah, we have to use this variable, which is nhb. Now this part will be symmetrical, and this all integrated by, in fact, sigma r. Okay, it is the same as BBR dz, and it will be equal as integral. Now we exchange kzy hbxdy and minus wx plus wz. So we exchange x and y, x and z places, and we obtain the same by the symmetry of k and jb in the fundamental identity. So now we have that, we have such equality, and this now integral, it's hb, it can be integrated first by z. And if we do that, then we will see that we have again the potential of the equilibrium measure for the ball, and we know what it is, and also we have that y belongs to b. So since y belongs to b here, means that y belongs to br. So in fact, this will be just Robin constant. You will integrate for the ball, so it will be minus logarithm r divided by p here. If we integrate by the measure mu br, and we will be left with integral over the hitting probability, that, but it is just one again, because the total weight of hitting probability is one right now. And now we say that it is equal the rest is just again integrated over the ball. So this will be minus bx, simply nothing else, integrated over it's not even integrated, it's just minus bx, and this will be integrated. Over the ball, over surface measure of the ball. So this is our potential, and we will see. We see that it is for if x belongs to the set of regular points, then wbx is equal to zero. So we have that k mu b equals to this constant. And this is exactly what we need. Then mu b is equilibrium measure. Of course, I also had to check that mu b has total measure 1, but it is clear by definition. If you look at the definition, then this measure has total weight 1 and this measure has total weight 1. So it's there, such integral also will have total weight 1. If I put ARD here, it will be 1. And we integrate and we can obtain 1. And the second condition, that mu b is concentrated on the set of regular points of b, well, it is just obvious because hb is also concentrated on the set of regular points of b for any y. So we have the first two conditions we just have by definition. So in fact, mu b is equilibrium measure, and this is Robin constant. This is what they needed to prove. So as you can see, it is possible to define equilibrium measure for two-dimensional Brownian motion, but in slightly unusual way when we replace, in fact, we replace the capacity with something new. We obtained such quantity instead of capacity. So in order to obtain the usual capacity, there are different approaches. There were different approaches. It is possible to define capacity as 1 divided by RB if RB is greater than 0. So this was one of the definitions. Of course, we know that the smaller the set, the bigger is RB. It is easy to see from the definitions. But we just need to take care that is greater than zero, and then we may define capacity, right? So it is possible to measure the weight of the sets by 1 divided by RB. Another possibility is to say that capacity is equal to exponent minus RB. So then this capacity will have the similar properties as usual capacity in R3 or RD for D greater than or equal than 3. Of course, you unfortunately do not have time to give you some properties of capacities, which will be the same. Yes, so for example, capacities, if set converges to, there are sections of set that converges monotonously to a set, then their capacities converge under some conditions. Of course, sets has to be bounded, sometimes closed, but it's the idea is very simple, so that capacity describes how often we hit the set, how probable for us to hit the set. So today I also want to prove one more theorem, which is also very interesting, because as you recall, maybe in dimension D greater than or equal than 3, before proving, even before proving this, the existence of equilibrium measures, we showed, we considered such picture. We took two balls with the same center, different radius. So radius P, radius Q. And we start from between the balls. And the question is, which is the probability that we hit this inner ball before we hit the boundary of outer ball? So this was solved using fundamental identity. So I also want to solve the similar problem in dimension 2 using fundamental identity. This is not needed as you saw for the equilibrium measure for dimension 2, but it is also interesting. So it is interesting to know what is such probability. So the theorem is that suppose we have such x that satisfy that its norm is between p and q, some positive number such that p less than q, then the probability that we hit this inside ball before we hit I defined it as like this. So so we hit inside ball before we hit the complement of outside ball, right? Is 1 minus probability that we hit the complement of the outer ball before we hit the inner ball. This the first equality is obvious because we know that such moments of hitting this sets are finite for dimension 2, because we know that in dimension 2 every set which has positive Lebesgue measure always hit with probability 1 at some finite moment of time. So this stopping time will be always finite, and I do not need to write anything else, and this will be the sum of such these probabilities will be 1. So we always hit either outer bound or inner bound. But this probability is equal to logarithm q minus logarithm x divided by logarithm q minus logarithm p. This is the claim. So the proof is that we just use fundamental identity for the set B, which is union of BP and RD minus BQ. So we take the set, such set that contains both inner ball and the complement of outer ball. For such set, we can use fundamental identity. And because of this, we know that we use fundamental identity at some point x, right? So, and point y will be just a second. What do we need to do here? Yeah, and point y will be 0. Exactly. So we say that kx0 will be jb will be 0, because 0 belongs to the set of regular points of b. Yeah, so because of this, jb will be absent, and we only have hb x dz kz0, which is very simple to find right now, but we have an additional term. Yeah, so now we will have this usual part, because kz0 is constant on this both inner and outer spheres. Well, right now it's just circles, but yeah, generally speaking, it's spheres, and hb is this integral over hb is exactly one probability multiplied. So if we hit BP first, then HB, then K, this KZ will be equal to its value on when norm Z is equal to P. So it will be equal to PX, this probability PX, of course, here X is exactly like this. And it will be multiplied by K Z0 when Z is on BP, on SP, so on the sphere, so it will be minus logarithm P divided by P. P by P. Okay. This and this the other summand is exactly this probability, and again multiplied by minus logarithm q divided by p. So the value of k on the corresponding circle. And everything would be good if we know that if we would know that this is zero. So of course everything is proved. Then. Theorem is proved. So we only need to prove that wx is zero. We do it using separate lemma. So lemma is as follows. So if we the set B is countable union of closed sets, and its complement is bounded, then WBX equal to zero everywhere. So again, we know the WBX equal to zero on the regular points of B, but now I claim that it is also zero everywhere. To prove that, I will use the definition of WB as limit. I recall that this is the limit of J lambda U multiplied by 1 minus expectation of exponent minus lambda tau b. And here we can use the following trick. We will say that if we multiply by lambda and then divide by lambda, then in fact we can consider limit of this and of this separately. Let me just start with this. I will write down definition, and we will see that in fact I recall that U is such that its norm is 1. So here we will have by definition lambda integral exponent minus lambda t pt u dt from 0 to plus infinity. But since this we may change variables and say that lambda t is our new variable s. Then we will have that p t will be s divided by lambda u. Clearly, this converges to zero as lambda converges to zero. Because u is fixed such like this. It will be, it is just easy from the explicit form of the density that if the time goes to infinity, then of course the value of this density goes to zero. And because of this will converge to zero as lambda converge to zero. So all we have to prove that this part is bounded, but in fact we may prove that it converges. Let me do this. So let me write this. Lambda tau b. It is possible to rewrite this as follows. If we take this inside the expectation and then write this as an integral from zero to tau b of exponent minus lambda tau b not tau b but some s ds. So if we just calculate this integral, this will be exactly this. But what does this mean? Means that we may rewrite it as an integral from 0 plus infinity, indicator that tau b greater than s, e minus lambda s ds. And this is in fact integral from 0 to plus infinity, e minus lambda s, probability so tau b is greater than s. So as you can see, this would easily, okay, let me write this greater than equal. Well, it's not, there is no difference, but maybe just for visual. Okay, so, and if lambda converges to zero, this would converge, question mark, to the integral px tau b greater than s ds, but only if this integral is finite. Of course, this integral is in fact exactly expectation of tau b. This is just, again, using an indicator, it is not so hard to see. So I only need to prove that this is finite. If I prove that this is finite, this expectation is finite, then I actually proved this quality. Prove this convergence. And I proved that this WB is zero. For each X, such that this expectation is finite, by these calculations, we will have that WB is fine, is zero. But we also know, let me write it lemma 2, so if B, if B is non-polar and bounded, again it is countable union of closed sets, B is bounded and non-polar. Just a second. Not B, but again, but we had here that its complement is bounded. So yeah, we need that its complement is bounded. Yeah, but in fact, I think it's true for more general case. Just let me think about it for a second. Okay, maybe not, maybe just for this case. Then expectation x tau b is finite. And to prove it, let me recall that this expectation, proof number two, expectation of tau b is in fact expectation of integral from 0 to tau b indicator such that xt belongs to its complement. Why such strange why such strange form? Because this is the time the process spent outside b before hitting b, right? So this is exactly the average the time of hitting b. But this is also has different notation, because when we let me write it next page, when we defined the process that the killed process, the process that killed when it hits B, this will be was exactly the definition. So we had that indicator tau b t, tau b greater than t, right? Tau b greater than t, and xt belongs to some set. Doesn't matter which set. This set can be anything, dt. But then it is, I can write plus infinity now and take expectation inside, and we will have that this is P B CRD yeah, integral, let me write it down like this, dy over set rd, let this be. So this is in fact, by definition, jb tx, sorry, the x minus y here, right? Because we start from x, and y is a point where we finish. So this will be like this. Or jbxy dy over this. And last time I proved that if that this is finite, if A is bounded. This is exactly what happens. So we know that it is in fact finite, and expectation is finite. This is the end of the proof. So we proved this lemma, as a result we proved previous lemma, and then we proved theorem 3. So we know what is the probability of hitting inside circle before hitting outside circle. And I think this will be it for today.